So my name is Jomo Johnson, also known as Joe Johnson for short. Was born in Honolulu, Hawaii. Didn't stay there too long, but then moved to Columbus, Georgia, where my family settled, mother, father, military dad. Long story short, I think, you know, I kind of live somewhat of a unique but traditional young African-American male experience in the South. I had a real strong female-led family. My father wasn't there after probably about the age of 4. So my mother, I was 2 older sisters, I was the baby. And then I also had a strong grandmother, strong aunt, a lot of educators in my family, and really successful women in my family. My great aunt, she owned, Lord knows how many acres she owned, but she was pretty well off. I had a grandmother who was a teacher in New Jersey for many years. Just really smart, really intelligent. My mother was a paraprofessional, worked various jobs. My sisters, you know, graduated Emory, Northwestern, just, you know, really, really good stock, I would say. But I think, you know, one of the challenges for me was kind of identity from the very beginning, not quite knowing who my dad was, not quite having a relationship with him, and also being the only male in kind of a female-led family. So that kind of created some strange identity things. You know, I wanted to be the hard guy, but I didn't have somebody to role model that except for rap music. But I also was very sensitive and aware, you know, because of kind of the, I guess, maybe being around women. And so that always didn't quite fit in with the image that I wanted to project, or kind of the masculine black male image that oftentimes is prioritized in some cultures. So, you know, like many youth and many black males who grow up without a dad, I kind of began to get in trouble, you know. Fight, hang out, drink, smoke, be disrespectful, you know, getting in trouble with in school and things of that nature. But, you know, I did recognize, even kind of in the middle of some of those things, which I think probably started maybe around 7th grade, I noticed that I had a passion for writing. Always have loved writing ever since 5th grade. Had a wonderful teacher in my elementary school. Her name was Miss Phillips. I think she was my English teacher, and she taught us creative writing. I still remember when she gave us an assignment of just writing whatever came to our mind, that my hand caught fire. I just couldn't stop writing, and that kind of was the first place where I saw a gift and a passion for writing and a love for writing. I remember, I think it was, I forgot what grade it was, maybe 7th grade, I wrote a paper on Nat Turner, kind of a, you know, a research paper on Nat Turner. And I think the last line was, Nat Turner shows that when a black man is pressured, that he's a force to be reckoned with. And I remember the white teacher called my parents. You know, they kind of showed me, man, the power of words here. This is strong. This is something. This is a superpower. So I loved writing, loved creating from there, but still kind of struggled, you know, with identity in high school, you know, not quite fitting in. I was shorter than most. I wasn't as popular as others. You know, my mother, she spoiled me. I had like the best clothes, the best shoes. I had gold chains. And so kind of was a target of jealousy by a lot of the people who I was trying to hang out with, because I just had so much stuff that was better than them. I wasn't as popular then, but they just looked at me and like, gosh, where's this dude getting all this stuff from? But it wasn't until the age of 17 when kind of all that came to a head, where I got into a fight, neighborhood fight, and with 2 guys, and was sentenced to do time in jail at the age of 17. This was like a couple days after I just turned 17 too. And it was kind of there where I believe God really started, you know, working in my heart, working in my life. John 6:44 says, no man comes to Jesus except the Father draw him. I want to pause here for a minute and just kind of record just a testimony. I was just praying. Because, you know, times can be challenging. And I remember that passage in which Jesus told Peter to go fishing. And he would find a fish with a coin in his mouth. And Peter was to use that to pay the taxes. And I just was, I just got a message. And that reminded me that God has resources that you don't see. You can't see, that are prepared and waiting for you to do his will. And I just got notification that out of nowhere, I got refunded for a pretty large purchase. Was not looking forward or expecting it. It just almost came out of nowhere. And it's just a reminder to me, or a lesson for me. God's faithful. To use the term humiliated by grace, when you absolutely know how completely, utterly unworthy you are of breath. But God says, I love him. And not only am I going to give him breath, but I'm going to give him everything, namely myself. Thank you, Jesus. I'm just humbled right now. But back to my story. It was in Muskogee County, Columbus, Georgia, when I was sentenced to do 9 months in county jail for that fight, that God got a hold of me. He did it through a couple different ways. Number one, I was not interested in God, but I recognized that he had been drawing me. I had been more curious about spiritual things, more curious about inquiring. I remember I was working as a waiter, and a pastor came in, or a priest came in. I like wanted to ask him Bible questions. You know, when I was sentenced, I told my mom, don't worry, Jesus will take care of me. Again, I wasn't a person of faith at that time, but I kind of can just see how God was drawing me back, or drawing me to himself. So I got to county jail, didn't have any thought of faith, religion, anything like that, but a couple things happened. Number one, there were some inmates that were holding a Bible study in the cells. And one of the Bible studies was held by a former pastor. So he kind of knew what he was doing. But I just remember kind of just the praise, the worship, and the joy in the community. And that just, obviously I'd been to church before, but it kind of just was something powerful about just men coming together to pray and worship God. So that left an impact on me. That kind of got me thinking about my own spiritual life. Secondly, I recognized where I was at. I was in a county jail, and I was there for a reason. I was there, yeah, I got into a fight, but ultimately I was there because of my sins. I had done bad things, and I had done sin against God, and that's what led me there. And I began to feel the conviction of my sin. And I remember being in that cell, asking the Lord to forgive me for every single sin I could think of. I remember rising from my knees and just feeling so much lighter, just that burden had been taken off. And then I was given a Bible and I read it, and it was as if the light switch went on. I was able to see it and understand it clearly, that Jesus was God, that he loved me so much that he would come to this world because of the things that I had done in this world, and he would die for me. And I really understood that God became man and died for Joe Johnson. And that blew me away, and I placed my faith in him, and I became a Christian, and I became saved. And that's where the journey started. for me. That's where the journey started, 1998. So that's 25 years ago. So many ups and downs, the most imperfect Christian life. But I think the one thing that I've been able to, or I should say God has revealed to me, is that Philippians 3:7, nothing is as wonderful as knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. I've given up everything else and counted all as garbage. All I want is Christ and to know that I belong to him. That's the contemporary English version. That the person of Christ, number one, is the greatest reality in life. His presence is the greatest reality in life. And that the pursuit of knowing him and enjoying him, and not just the pursuit, but knowing and enjoying him, is the greatest goal in life. The greatest goal in life. So, you know, throughout the trials, the troubles, the challenges, I've always tried to make that my pursuit. It probably was around the age of 23 that I sensed a call to ministry, Christian ministry. I noticed two things within myself. Number one, I felt I perceived the gift of hospitality, where I wanted to welcome people, invite them in, a kindness, a gentleness. And looking back, I feel like, you know, being raised amongst women kind of taught me hospitality, but God kind of fostered that gift upon my salvation. And then secondly, just a desire to proclaim God's word. I remember being incarcerated and I was still telling people about Jesus and even preaching. And that showed me that I had that God had given me a boldness and courage to be able to proclaim his word, that his word was so worth it, that it was worth shouting in a prison yard that Jesus is Lord. I remember when I was in prison that I would take Bible tracts and scriptures, and while I was working the kitchen, kind of the mess hall, I would pass out little tracts to inmates. I didn't know who they were. I would just pass them out to people. And I think about that. I don't really think I understand or really have thought about the impact of doing that. One inmate told me that I was the most inspirational person he had ever met. And this was while I was incarcerated. And I was like, okay, right, whatever that means. But I think, as I think about it now, being able to give out God's word to inmates who probably felt terrible or felt bad or felt just like defeated, just in their private time, to be able to have them, you know, to read that scripture and God just speaking to them directly through that. It's a powerful blessing to be a part of sharing God's word, especially with those in those situations. So I think God kind of just created within me a hunger to thirst for him, but also to make him known. So I saw, you know, how sacrifice and self-death is really the way to blessing. And it's so strange. It took me many years, I think, to learn that, because even in American Christianity, it's kind of like, you know, talent, gift, ability, blessing. It's not loss, death, humiliation, blessing of usefulness. The blessing isn't always financial or tangible. It's being able to be used by God in ways that you normally wouldn't. That's the real blessing. And so, you know, from the time of ministry, I've been willing to kind of say, okay, let me sacrifice. And it, to be honest, it oftentimes comes by, you know, just hard lessons. When I made the choice to go to grad school, to seminary, I was engaged to be married to someone who I thought was just like, well, she was just a beautiful person. I mean, just physically and I thought spiritually, but she didn't want to move to Philadelphia, even though she had committed to doing it. And I had to make the choice whether I was going to not go to grad school, not go to seminary for the sake of staying in my hometown to be with her, to marry her. And I mean, it was a challenging choice, but it wasn't so much of a hard choice because, number one, I already had committed. But secondly, I felt this was part of God's preparation and planning and God's calling. And I made that choice to go to Philadelphia to kind of leave mother, fatherland behind for my sake, for his sake. And I didn't marry her. So that kind of was an indication to me that, yeah, this is kind of the road. That sacrifice is kind of the road in the Christian life. And not just sacrifice, but kind of deeper sacrifice. Because not every Christian is called to sacrifice a wife or house for the gospel, and that's fine. But I think in the realm of ministry, there is kind of that call that you're, you know, you have to be willing to lay things down, to put them to the side, to put them to death if you're going to achieve what God wants to birth, which is his name and his glory in his people in his time. So that kind of was one of the first things. I remember when I looked at the cost of seminary and I was like, oh Lord. And the passage where Jesus says, they that leave father, mother, land behind for my sake shall be rewarded 100-fold. So I tell people, tell myself that I multiply the cost of seminary times 100. I'm like, Lord, you owe me. Lord, you owe me. You know, obviously jokingly. But I just, I held on to that promise, and that kind of set a trajectory for me of self-sacrifice. You know, going into ministry in seminary, I felt a strong call to minister to the people of North Philadelphia. And, you know, I sacrificed. I think I took a student loan check and I got a building and I started the church with it. And moved into Philadelphia, North Philadelphia, that. And it was hard. My car was broken into. I was assaulted. Not violently, but still assaulted. A lot of slander. But I kind of, you know, looking back, I kind of saw that as a necessary sacrifice, you know, to kind of do God's work and to do ministry in that area. And, you know, the church was able to sustain for, I think it's still going. I stayed there 4 years. So again, just kind of that trajectory of sacrifice. And I think also, you know, there's a level of self-care sacrifice that I had to learn during those last years of ministry, church ministry. You know, I began to struggle with addiction. I fell back into, I wasn't using marijuana, but I was drinking and I was using powder cocaine. And I was sleeping with different women. I fell into sin during that time. And I felt like, you know, I had given so much that I didn't have anything else to give, and I was looking for something to fill me. And I kind of went back to those vices. And, you know, it makes you humble to recognize that, yeah, even though I'm saved, I still can fall. But also, it showed me that I needed to depend on God's grace even more. You know, I know how good he is. I know what he's calling me to. And if I don't fulfill that calling, I'm going to look for something else to fill that void. And I had also had to recognize that the calling was not just to ministry. It was to a person, Jesus. Like, I'm going to be with Jesus a lot longer than I'm going to be a minister. So I kind of had to reconcile those two things. And there was some tug of war in that, you know, tug of war. A lot of dark seasons, dark years during that time. But a sovereign God uses all of those things to even build you up. God uses even the worst failures to draw you to himself. Doesn't mean you're going to be a super minister or a flourishing ministry. But what it means is that he's going to use that to give you a clearer picture of himself. And ultimately, that is the goal. The greatest convert any minister can have or make is themselves. When you convert yourself to believe and to know Jesus is enough. Because again, for the greatest ministers, most of them, they're going to retire. But to know that Jesus is enough, that is the goal of the individual life. So, you know, Jesus really taught me those things and still has and still is. And I struggled, you know, where to find my place in ministry. I never felt like I quite fit, you know. I wanted to be a pastor. I always wanted to be a pastor, but I felt like you know, I was being called into different areas. Like, I felt like a strong call to music and to art. And I knew a pastor is someone who has to really sacrifice to say, no, I'm not going to dibble and dabble into music, movies, and art. I'm going to focus on this flock that God has given me and give all my attention to them. So the pastor, there's a death in that too. And I struggled with that because I felt like, you know, I couldn't quite confine myself. I didn't quite fit a normal pastor role. So for years, I struggled. You know, I compare it to a stray dog, you know, not having a home, just going from place to place. But a sovereign God uses wandering to bring you to rest. And I'm thankful because in the pursuit of both his person and his calling, there is a revelation of his rest. So as you pursue, number one, him, secondly, as you pursue his purpose, you'll find a place, kind of your Canaan land, your rest, that sweet spot that God has called you to be in. And it's hard. It doesn't come easily. It doesn't come easily. And oftentimes, a lot of, you know, just like in the Old Testament, the Israelites still had to battle some of those little small nations who they didn't quite completely destroy. Those nations were always kind of a nuisance. So it does take time for some of those entanglements to kind of be untangled so that there's a clearer picture and revelation. But God, in his sovereignty, uses even that time to build the character, the experience, and the knowledge. So it's just an amazing story of God's sovereignty, of how he uses all things, including time, to work for good. So, you know, not quite knowing where to fit in ministry, fallback was always writing. I knew at least if I couldn't preach or teach, I knew I could write about the faith experience, write about my journey, or write about others. And that could be a means or a conduit to be able to communicate Christ in ways that I couldn't or didn't know how to. So 2018, on a mission trip, seeking to start these house churches, after working with an organization, and had the idea of, okay, I'm lonely, I'm isolated, I want to do God's purpose, but I also want to connect with people. How can I connect? How does the Bible connect with people? Through story. So decided to experiment with this storytelling company, SMS Novel, which is, you know, I did a lot of interesting things, text message novels, Zoom novels, a lot of stuff. Some caught on, some didn't. But it was, for the most part, pretty successful. But saw a greater medium, which was how we could preach Christ through film. And when I say film, obviously there are a lot of Christian movies and film out there. But to combine the power of accessible film with Christian testimony. So to be able to hear and take someone's testimony and to convert it into a script and to film a 60-minute or a 90-minute movie, just like you would self-publish a book. To make what God has done and what God is doing in people's lives as visible as possible. The Bible is always and will always be the source and greatest source of truth, but testimony is also a source of truth, as it states in Revelation. They overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony. And so to be able to make Christian testimonies visual or Christian stories visual, I felt that this is another way to preach the gospel that we probably haven't thought about. I mean, when we talk about preaching the gospel, we don't think about, okay, let's put out a Christian movie. We say, no, let's go preach. Let's go do a mission. Let's go pass out tracts. Let's, you know, that is usually the way. But, you know, Abraham Kuyper, every square inch of every square inch belongs to Christ. That includes film. And so I feel like God kind of is calling me to be a missionary through film. And it's a unique challenge because I have a lot to learn. I don't know much about film. I've tried to stay away from it. Books have always been my forte. But every missionary has to experience something that they've never experienced to do the work. Basically, you're not a missionary until you do it. And so I really sense and feel like God is calling me to this particular space to create these godly good films. You know, and I look at my background, Bible college degree, divinity degree, seminary, Reformed theology, and how all of those characteristics of education and experience actually lead me and can lead me and help me to create films that are Christ-centered and not self-centered or seeking money or anything like that. You know, I love Tyler Perry. I love Tyler Perry. And I think what he's done is amazing. And it's definitely a godsend. He's helped so many people. And I think what I want to try to do is maybe build on what he's done. You know, he's like the Old Testament, you know, kind of just funny, black, inspirational, uplifting storytelling, where it just kind of, you know, lets you know, yeah, there is hope in the midst of darkness. But my hope is to create 100% Christ-centered films where people have a clear understanding of who Jesus is, his sufficiency, and his calling through these stories. That's my hope. And I think, you know, I feel in a sense that God is preparing me for that and providing for that. I've seen this evidence of just provision after provision, kind of saying, you know, go this way. This is the way. This is the way. This is the way. And it's scary because, you know, you never know how things are going to work out. But ultimately, God, who has been faithful before I was born and since, he's trustworthy. So I want to continue the journey, and I want to say thank you all for taking the time to visit SMS Novel and kind of hear what we're doing here. You know, it's an invitation for you to be a part. And I think as we do this together, there's a mutual learning, there's a mutual sharing, there's a mutual joy. And my hope is that we can worship Christ together as we offer our talents and our skills to be able to create these films. I don't know what the future holds, but I know that which is done for Christ will be the only thing that lasts. Every blockbuster movie and film will burn at his coming. It will burn. And it won't be remembered anymore. But those films and stories that are a testimony to the grace, love, power, and work of God through Christ, they will last eternity. They will last. So what we want to create is something that will last. And so I invite you to take part of what SMS Novel is doing. Thank you so much for taking the time to listen to this. I really appreciate it. And I hope that you can hear my heart through what I'm sharing. And also I hope that your heart is kind of fueled with the possibility of what Christ can do in, through, and for you as you're willing to follow him no matter what the cost. Thank you.